Kia ora, welcome back to Q&A. Ken Wyatt is a man of firsts. The first Aboriginal person to be a cabinet minister, the first to be a minister for Indigenous Affairs. But can he achieve what politicians before him have not? That is, to have his people recognised in Australia's constitution, their voice permanently enshrined in Parliament. Ken Wyatt sat down with One News Australian correspondent Ryan Boswell to explain how he hoped to rally the country behind him.
An anomaly in Australian politics.
What I want is recognition that strengthens this nation.
Ken Wyatt, the Minister for Indigenous Australians, the first who is himself Indigenous, is carrying the weight of a people on his shoulders. Sworn into the National Liberal Coalition this year, he's wearing a cloak made from kangaroo skin, gifted to him by his tribe.
You carry a great deal of pride when you wear something like that, I would imagine.
Oh, you do, because it's given to you by your elders, and when they give it to you, it has meaning and it's significant.
His office in Canberra, full of treasures, each with a story to remind him of why he's here. This painting by his sister sits pride of place.
This one's about constitutional recognition, the mainstream communities and then the Indigenous communities, but coming together with a common purpose.
Elected to the Hasluck seat in the West in 2010, he became the first Indigenous person in the House of Representatives. He is the first to serve as a government minister too, and the first appointed to cabinet where the big decisions are made. Ken Wyatt quick to convince Prime Minister Scott Morrison to put Australia's first people at the front of minds. A referendum will be held in this term of Parliament, asking whether Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders should be recognised in Australia's founding document.
Well, there's been conversations, but sometimes you can have a conversation that is one way, where you tell people what they need, you tell people what you're going to put into place. A two-way conversation where you do it together is a very different approach.
The battle is big. Over the next 18 months, officials will be sent across the country to talk to the hundreds of different tribes, each with its own mix of cultures, customs and languages. Then a decision has to be made over what new word should be used to change the constitution. He says that will be key to get the country on board.
How ridiculous is that?
One Nation leader Pauline Hanson describes herself as Indigenous, arguing she too was born here. She says the Constitution is supposed to unite, not divide.
Pauline, I get on well with, and we've had some really good discussions. We both agree to disagree on some issues, and I jokingly said to her on the way out, looks like I'm going to have to do some sweet talking to convince you, and she said, all you have to do is be honest with me. And I like that in people.
Ken Wyatt has looked to Aotearoa for leadership on Indigenous rights, having attended conferences at Marae. He wants a bilateral agreement so knowledge can be shared.
But New Zealand has been tremendous at being at the forefront of the way it takes its First Nations people, embraces them, but embraces language. I love the New Zealand national anthem because you've got the duality of both cultures in the broadest context of cultures. And it sounds great. And then you watch when we play you in rugby union, the haka. And your Prime Minister's leadership has been tremendous.
He thought New Zealand's Treaty of Waitangi, signed between Māori and the Crown in 1840, could guide debate in Australia, but has since ruled that out.
Well, when I was young, I was envious of the Treaty of Waitangi because I thought that was the total solution. And I've always thought treaties gave you absolute certainty. But over a period of time, in watching what happens in another country, you learn a number of elements that are perfect, but you also learn that treaties aren't watertight.
In Australia, the disparities are glaringly obvious. Because of colonisation, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders have experienced extreme hardship. There's been the loss of traditional culture. Land has been stolen, children too taken by force from their loved ones, and they've been denied basic human rights, access to health, housing, education and employment.
I will bring with it a cultural perspective. so that when we have discussions, I'll be asking the question of, so how do we hear the voices of people in community? How do we hear what's being said at the regional level? Because if we operate at the national level and you have it top down, then the programs won't stay in place. And what I want to do is have a partnership in which we develop things together. It is owned and then the community run it.
There have been five inquiries into Indigenous rights. The latest, the Uluru Statement from the Heart, called for a First Nations voice in the Constitution and a process of agreement making and truth telling.
How long do you think it'll be before Indigenous Australians are on equal footing with white Australia?
I hope we make significant progress to moving the next generation of young people that come behind us into better positioning than what we were. It's the same as my parents and grandparents. I'm in a better position than they ever were at this age. So Australia is maturing. But the gap of equity is still problematic.
An interesting man. Tonight is up next. Thanks for watching. Ngā mihi ki a koutou mō ngā karere. That means thanks for your messages. Sorry we didn't get to your feedback. It's my fault. Thanks to the Q&A team. Hei te rā wiki. We'll see you next Monday evening.
Q&A is made with the support of New Zealand On Air.